Hi there, it's Bill again with a second video in the introduction to Chapter 4. In the first video, we covered some important stuff, and that is the types of repetition structures, and we did several examples of how to use both while and for loops to construct very useful little programs. So now we're going to cover, that was kind of a big topic, now we're going to cover some other smaller ones, running totals, sentinels, and we'll see how far we get in this particular video. So the next thing we want to talk about is running totals. Very often when you go through the loop, you need to either keep a count of how many times you've been through the loop, especially if you're in a while loop, but you also may want to accumulate totals of how many things you've seen go by. For instance, if you're asking for employee hours, you might need to add those up within the loop so that when you get out of the loop, you have a total created. That's called a running total. That just means in the loop, you're accumulating those things. The basic concept is really straightforward. You create the variable outside the loop and you zero it out. You always want to start the counter at zero. Sometimes there's a reason to start it somewhere else, but in general, zero. And then inside the loop, you simply add to that variable whatever thing you're accumulating. Obviously, if you're counting something, you add one, but usually you're accumulating things like hours or something like that. And then outside the loop, you have the value, which you can return or display or whatever. Now, for example, let's say we want to add up all the numbers between 1 and 100. It's pretty straightforward, but let's do that as a demonstration so that we can see the running total thing in action. So let's start with a fresh slate here, and we're going to do that example together. So let's create a thing called addNums, right? We're going to create a function called addNums, and let's say that the user gets to tell us where to start and then where to end. Alright, so we could make it a little more flexible. If you don't want to add just 1 to 100, you could start at, 15 and go to 35. Alright, so that's our function definition. So the classic way to do a running total is that you set up a variable. Doesn't have to be the word total, it can be whatever you want, but we'll set up the variable and assign 0 to it. And then we say, because in this case we know that this is going to be a counter-based operation, we can use a for loop. Because we know we know how many times it's going to run because it starts and ends, right? That's not a mystery. So we know we can use a for loop, and then we need to have a variable that's going to go one by one marching through the range of numbers. So I'll just say a num for a number in. Now in this case we don't have a particular collection or sequence to iterate through, but we can of course use our range concept. And what do we want to do? Where do we want to start the range? Well, we want to start with whatever number the user gave us, and where do we want to end? End num. Okay. Now I've made a mistake, but we're going to see that in a minute, and we'll fix it as we go. Now for each time through, what do we want to do? Well, in this case, we're not asking the user to enter anything. We're simply adding up the numbers. So we really have nothing to do inside the loop except do the running total. The classic way to do that is you say total equals total plus, and then you put whatever you're adding up. Right? So what are we adding up in this case? Well, we're adding whatever value happens to be in a num this particular time through the loop. Right? So this is our running total accumulator. Right? It's also called an accumulator. All right? Pretty straightforward, right? Now, one other thing to note here is this works fine, right? This is perfectly fine notation, but you'll often see this particular thing instead of saying total equals total plus a num, you'll very often see total plus equals a num, right? That's another clever operator that does the same thing. It says just add a num into whatever was in total before. So that's a little more classic, classic use there. All right, now when we're done with the loop, we really only need to print the total to prove that we have it right. So it's very straightforward. And then we just need to call this and see. Now again, we've made a mistake, so let's go through and let's test it. Let's call addNums. Always start with an easy test case, so let's do 1, 2, 2, or 3, right? Make it very straightforward. All right, let's run it and see what we get. Okay, we get 3. Okay, what's the problem here? Why do we get 3 here when we're adding up the numbers between 1 and 3? It ought to be 1 plus 2 is 3 plus 3 is 6. Well, if you look at this and think about the range command, remember I told you earlier in earlier video that this goes from start num to not quite, right? It will never actually get to end num. So if we go, if we put a range of 5, it's going to go 0 through 4. So this end num is the thing that lets it know it's done, but it will never actually get to that value. So we want it to get to that value in this case, so I'm going to simply say plus 1 here. Right, we just need to go one more number than we were expecting here. And that's going to solve our problem, and that's going to mean we get 6, which is the number we expect to do. So that's a quick example. Now, if we needed a counter, that would not make sense in this case because we already know how many times it's going to run, but let me just show you what a counter would look like. Right, and this would be a counter. Right? So that's the classic form. So if you say the variable plus equals 1, that's a counter. If you say variable plus equals something else, that's an accumulator. So that gives you an idea of how running totals work. Stop, pause, look if you want to do it yourself, and then we'll move on to the next example. All right, so that's a little bit about running totals. Next is sentinels. Sentinel values are a clever way for you to signal that something is done, right? Sometimes it's something that the user gives you to let them know they're done, or you might use them like at the last record in a file. You can use it anytime you want to signal the program by some particular piece of data that something is to finish. Now typically that data needs to be something very outlandish, unusual, invalid, something that doesn't get treated as real data. It needs to be a signal, so it needs to be different. So a very simple option here would be this first example, which let the user enter employees and work hours until they give you a sentinel of an employee number of 4 zeros, right? That's an invalid employee number, so once you signal that, then you know you're done. Another example we won't do, but we will do later, is a menu that lets you keeps the user trapped until they do an exit, choose an exit option. So let's do this example of employee numbers and hours until they provide a zero. That would be a good one to do together. Okay, so let's start here, and we're going to create a function called total employee hours. No parameters in this one. Now we know we're going to do a total of hours, so that gives us a hint that we're going to need to have a running total. So I'm going to say total emp hours equals 0. We just know that's coming. Now, this is a very typical construction too, because of the fact that we test at the top, right? We often do this idea where you either have to set the thing equal to something to get it into the loop, right? Set the variable to something to get into the loop, or you have to seed it with a value that forces it into the loop. In other words, you got to get the loop started if you want to run the loop at all. So we know we're going to say something like this: while employee num is not equal to the sentinel value dot 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 dot, right? But employee num doesn't exist, so we can't actually do this test. So somehow here we need to set the value of emp num, and it needs to get a value that will get us started properly in the loop. In this case, the easiest thing is probably to prime the loop by simply asking the employee number at the top, right? So in this case, I'm going to just ask the user, right? Say, hey, enter employee number or blah 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 to exit. Right, so I have an input statement that gathers the employee number. Now, if you stop and think about this, this is going to let you decide that you don't ever want to do this at all. Right? You may decide to not even enter one valid employee number. If you type 0000 at the very top, that's fine. It's just going to exit, and you're going to have a total hours of 0. That's perfectly fine. So this is a nice construction where you don't necessarily know if you need to run the loop at all. We're not forcing them to enter one valid employee. That's just kind of nice. So this is a typical construction. Now inside here, we know we have asked for the employee number. Now we need to ask for the hours. And we're going to get a floating point number, and we're going to input from the user, enter employee hours. Right, close two parens, and you'll see that finishes off that, which is great. Now, we want to make sure we add up those hours. We're doing a running total, so we need to do the typical thing here. which is take the name of the accumulator variable and plus equals what? Emp hours, right? So we're adding the hours onto it. And then, notice this is an important point, we need to make sure that in this method we've primed outside, we've primed the loop by getting the first value, we start the loop, but we need to make sure we're making progress toward completing the loop, which means we need to ask them inside the loop for another employee number. So I'm going to take this. If we don't do that, we're going to have an infinite loop because they can never make progress toward typing in 0000. It's never a possibility if you don't ask them. Okay, does that make sense? And then once we're out, we've done all the right stuff here, so we can say total employee hours, and then we can print the variable total emp hours. Okay, so stop and look at that. See if you agree that that should do approximately what's right. And then let's say we're going to call the thing and see if it works. Now typically I make sure this is a very typical error is you forget the colon here, that looks right. We've got the colon here, that looks right. Looks like everything's good. So let's see what happens and let's type in some employees and hours and let's do a little testing. I'm going to hit F5, enter the employee number. Well, I'm going to do 1 by just typing the zeros and exit. Okay, that seemed to work fine, so that test case succeeded. Now, what I might want to do is I suppose I could put an if statement around this print so that if it's 0, I didn't even bother, because if they just exited, really I have nothing to display. So that could be a little modification, but we won't bother. Try it again, and I'm going to do employee number 1234, and they worked 11 hours, and employee 2345 worked 7 hours, and then I'm done. 1234 zeros. And I have 18 hours total. Hey, looks great. That's not a lot of testing, but a little testing seems to indicate that we're on the right track here. So this used a running total, and it also used a sentinel value that the user typed in when they wanted to signal you that they were done. So we could bulletproof this program a little more. Right now, if they enter something that's not a number for the employee hours, it's going to blow up. But that's a concept for another day, and we'll leave that for then. All right. So that's a quick example of using both a running total and a sentinel. So pause the video here if you like, type it in yourself, and inspect it a little bit, and then we'll move on to the next example. Okay. This one, fun, input validation loops. Often you ask the user a question, you ask them for some specific choices, let's say from a menu or something that you need them to type in, and if they don't type it correctly, you want to keep pestering them until they do it correctly, right? You want to force them to do it, and you keep asking them until they do. This is called an input validation loop, where you're making sure you keep looping until you get the data that you want. So a very typical way to do this would be a menu. A very typical use for this would be in a menu where they have certain choices, 1, 2, 3, and 0 for exit, and you want to keep them asking them for a menu choice until they comply, until they answer the question correctly. So that's pretty straightforward, right? That's pretty cool. So let's write this one together, an input validation loop. And now to get us started, I can probably get us started a little bit. Let's start with define a thing called showMenu, a function called showMenu, no parameters. Now, just to make life a little bit easier, I've pre-done the menu, right? Because that's kind of a pain to type in for you to watch me type in. So there we go. Let's see here. There we go. Okay, so here's the display of the menu. That's not the interesting part. Now, the next part is we want to let's make some comments here. Show the menu, and now let's get the choice. Okay, now how do we do this thing? Well, we know we're going to need a loop because we want to trap the user in until they choose something valid off this list. So what kind of a loop is it? Do we know how many times? No. Do we know some sort of collection that we're processing? Nope. So we know it has to be a while loop for this particular case. All right, so we do a while loop, and now what is that going to be? Well, we want the user to type in a menu choice. Obviously, we haven't gathered that yet, so that's an interesting one. And we want to think of a condition here that's going to help. So what is the condition? The loop needs to keep running, keep pestering while what is true? Well, if they choose something invalid, we keep pestering them. So what does that mean? Well, if the choice is less than zero, we obviously, that's invalid, we need to ask them again. Or the menu choice is, type correctly, greater than 3. Right? Now, think about this one a second. It can't be and, right? Because and would be you could never have a number that is both less than 0 and greater than 3. So it has to be or, and it has to be this particular way. So in other words, we're saying while invalid choice. So this is a condition that describes invalid choice. Now, somewhere before we get here, we can't do this without having a value in menu choice to begin with. So we either need to ask the user for it before we get into the loop to get the loop started, or we need to put in something invalid so that it gets into the loop the first time. So this is a typical thing that I do, is put in something outlandish, right? The user's probably not going to type negative 99. It's certainly invalid, so it's certainly going to make the loop true, and so it'll get us started in the loop. All right, next, what are you going to do? Well, not a lot to do inside here except ask them for the menu choice, right? So we say we want the integer result of the input of select option. Close one paren, close two parens, that looks right. Now, that's really it. It's so incredibly simple. We trap the user in and keep asking them select option, select option, select option until they comply and do something valid. Now, once we're done, let's just print for our own purposes, user made a valid choice number menu choice. Okay, I've typed a quote instead of an apostrophe. You can see the green was a signal for that. Okay. So really, that's all there is to it. It's a very, very simple thing to do a menu, an input validation loop like this. And so now I'm just going to call this thing. I'm going to call show menu, and we're going to see if it works. And I'm going to, let's see, have I made any of my typical mistakes? Nope, I don't think so. All right, so there's the menu. I'm going to type negative 2. Nope, select option. 5, 7. Nope. Nope, 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 keeps asking me. Now, does it let me out with a 0? Sure does. Now let's do another run of it, and let's try valid options. Valid option 1? Yes, certainly does. Okay, so one thing we might do in this program is rather than having the loop only around this, we might consider moving all of the showing of the menu inside the loop so that if they make an invalid choice, they show the menu, they see the menu again. Otherwise, eventually it's going to be off the screen and they're not even going to see it. So that's one little upgrade I think I would make to this program. Now, this is a cool one, and we're doing some neat stuff with input validation. Hope that makes sense. Again, pause, type it in yourself if you like, and if you have questions, you know, think about them, send them in. We have another example to do still that's very powerful, so we'll stop the video here because it's getting a little bit long. It will continue in a third video, but thanks for watching this one.